Greetings, CoVMail viewers. For more than 60 years, Rao Hospital has catered to the healthcare needs of women and children excellently in Coimbatore. COVID-19 has posed a lot of challenges to health sector, and how Rao Hospital has come up with solutions is what we are going to see in this video. We shall have an interaction with Dr. Damodar Rao, Associate Director of Rao Hospital.
The lockdown was implemented and we were worried about how exactly to go. The lockdown was maybe suddenly implemented also. Do not ask people to become pregnant now, because we don't know the effect of the virus on pregnancy or on the embryos that are formed. How did we actually tackle these problems? We did was talk to the patient through the phone itself. Every time they come across a patient, they ask a couple of questions to see. Definitely technology is going to be the game changer here. We were only attending to emergencies or essential services. So what next for hospitals? What is the future of hospitals? Hello everybody, I'm Dr. Damodar Rao, consultant in infertility and laparoscopy at Rao Hospital, Coimbatore. Today we're here to talk about the problems that we faced during the lockdown and the solutions that we came up with. The first thing is how, you know, the lockdown was implemented and we were worried about how exactly to go. The lockdown was maybe suddenly implemented also. So we had to tell our patients as that, you know, regular appointments will not happen. That we'll have to decide as to what we will do with each person's cycle. We are a hospital that deals with infertility, pregnancy and laparoscopy. So IVF is not just a one-time visit. It is a whole cycle. It's for a whole month. So all these patients, you know, were very anxious because they come to us for infertility treatment and they've also probably paid an advance or something like that, and they were wondering what is going to happen next. So we had to really counsel them, saying that, you know, a lot of counseling was required because they were very anxious. And we explained to them that nothing to worry at all. This is only something that is temporary and we will be resuming our cycles within 1 or 2 months. We had to do this because even our governing bodies had told us, do not do any IVF cycles now. Do not ask people to become pregnant now, because we don't know the effect of the virus on pregnancy or on the embryos that are formed. Only the patients that were midway of the cycle, of course, we completed their cycles and we have frozen their embryos now. Pediatric side also, our pediatrician spoke to all the patients. We told them that there is no need for vaccination immediately. We called the patients. A lot of tele consultation was done. We told them, don't be anxious, don't be worried, and that we will call you when the time is right. So the next part is about, you know, how did we actually tackle these problems? We prioritize the patients based on who has to be treated on an urgent basis, who are not so urgent, and whose treatment can be really postponed. So based on that, we divided it into three, and accordingly we called the patients and told them that this is what we're doing. Because of the lockdown, everybody cannot travel so far. You're putting yourself also at risk. So technology really came into place right now. We did a lot of teleconsultation, we did a lot of video consultations, and we told the patients not to travel. If you can do a scan, if you're pregnant, we told them don't travel all the way. You can do a scan nearby, you can do a blood test close by. And now the government has also allowed us to give prescriptions through tele or video consultations. It is legal, and hence we were able to really help the patients. So the next thing is we did was talk to the patient through the phone itself. The screening started right from the phone call that you have with the patient. We would ask the patient, well, you know, have you traveled? Where are you coming from? Are you coming in from a cluster where there are other cases nearby, or have you come into contact with a patient who has been positive of recent? So all this we take into account, and then we decide and tell the patient whether they should come at all or not. Next, we would tell the patients to come to the hospital. Pregnancies, we had to look after all the pregnancies. We could not not stop seeing these pregnancies. So we had to call them for scans, we had to do our blood tests, and we had to continue care for all the pregnant women we were seeing. So we would schedule their appointment. We would not crowd the hospitals. We would see that there are not more than 4 people in a particular area of the hospital. And of course, all the other things, like, you know, we have a screening desk right when you enter. Somebody would again ask you all these questions that I mentioned. So all this again would happen at our screening desk. If again there is a patient who is little suspicious, we have something called an emergency room that we have made separately now, and a separate doctor for that. Again, she will also examine the patient and decide if she required further investigations or anything. If we suspected further, and the patient really had to be taken care of, we also have an isolation ward. So we separate these patients from the rest of the crowd. So that way we took care to see that the patients were not getting mixed. So for the patients whom we've actually given an appointment, again to prevent overcrowding, we would ask them only to step into the hospital once they're, the doctor is ready for them. We would ask them to wait in the car till then, so that they are less exposed to other people and other patients. That is one thing we did. And once the patient entered, of course, the screening desk I've spoken about, then of course all our staff, they wear your face shield, they wear your masks, they wear your gloves, and they also, every time they come across a patient, they ask a couple of questions to see if anything is suspicious, or fever or any other symptoms like that. Our doctors are also wearing the whole protective gear. They're wearing, some of them wear the PPE itself. If they think they're in close contact with the patient, like in the scan room, they wear the PPE, the N95 mask, the gloves. So this way we are protecting our doctors, our staff, and we're protecting the patients. By using all this protective gear, we're protecting both of them. So this is also something that we have done. We were only attending to emergencies or essential services. So patient came in pain or something like that and required emergency surgery, yes, we would definitely do a surgery for the patient. Again, such patients, if it is an emergency, we would use the complete PPE kits in the operation theater. Everybody, right from the surgeon to the assisting nurse to the anesthetist, everything was taken care of. If the patient had to undergo some sort of surgical procedure or any even admission, we are taking care that the patient does a COVID test. So all our patients also know that this particular patient who is going to get admitted is COVID negative. This will also keep all the patients who are already admitted happy that this person, this new patient that is coming into the hospital, is also COVID negative. And we also repeat a COVID, if at all, if they've come some time back and if they need one more admission, we are asking them to do a COVID test, because this will keep everybody safe. And one more thing we are doing is throughout the hospital, be it OP or IP, reduce the number of attenders. Before, especially when it's pregnancy, it's a very happy moment. You have 3-4 people or even sometimes a whole village coming to see if it's a delivery especially. So now we've made it very, very strict that whatever it is, even if it is a delivery, the patient will have only one attender. Or even if it is to the OP, the patient will have only one attender. We also have markings around the whole hospital, like even each area, like if it is the cash department, we have markings on the ground that this person has to stand on this cross, the next person has to stand a few feet away. So all this, precautions we're taking so that enough social distancing is being maintained. We're not letting our whole staff strength, doctors or staff, come to the hospital at the same time. We've divided them into two teams. We're calling one team for a week and the next team the next week, so that in case unfortunately a COVID patient walks in, government sometimes will say all these people who have been in contact with the particular patient will have to be quarantined. So we don't want to lose all our staff at the same time. So if at all there is a patient that walks in at that time, COVID positive patient, we have a backup team to always help us with any other problem. So what next for hospitals? What is the future of hospitals? COVID is here to stay with us for some time, maybe for the next few months, maybe at least for the next 6 months as we see. So the future will be definitely social distancing has to be maintained. We will have to rely on technology a lot. Technology is going to really, really help us overcome this barrier. Specialty wise, I'm sure new devices and new methods will come up, but we will have to start using technology more. Sometimes the medical field can be a little behind in this, and we are bucking up now by using more technology, more software, and we will also, doctors and patients, I think, will learn to respect each other's time also more. We will see that patients are seen to at the right time. Patients will also see that they do not come late for appointments. So I think on the whole, patients and doctors will also learn to respect each other's time more. And definitely technology is going to be the game changer here.